Today we're going to talk about how to install a TFT display on the Bigtree Tech Octopus Max Easy version 1.0. Now, as you might suspect, we don't have our normal ribbon cables on this one, but we do have our TFT port down in here. So we're going to have to locate that in order to install it. Now, on the back side of this, I'll show you that we actually are using RS-232 to connect it. Now, that's important for you to know for the connection, and it's a notched connector. So, in order to install this, we're going to have to go over and check to see what the information is. So, I'm going to go over to the desktop, and what you're going to see here is the actual repositories. Now, we obviously have our TFT touchscreen software. I'm not going to show you how to do the firmware update in this video. I've done it several times on my channel. But I will download the actual code to this over here locally so you can see what's going on. But essentially, the directions are written down below on how to do this. And there's also a little cheat sheet for what you need to set for the particular stepper, hopefully. So let's see if we can find it real quick. Here we go. So they talk about different connectors, and then you can choose the actual connection to your actual board down in here. Now, our board is not listed currently in here because I think it's new. So I'll show you how to find out or guess what it is. But it also talks about different screen settings. So let's go back a second here. What we're going to need to do is find our particular display. So we're going to type TFT, if I can spell correctly. There we go. So here's our display that we're currently using. And inside here, there's obviously a manual that we can either pull up here or download. Now, I basically know how to set it up, so I'm not going to show you the manual, but this is your reference material on their GitHub page. So let's go over and see what we need to connect on our actual board, because we have a special connector where we need to find the reset portion to connect this correctly. So if I go over here and I go to the very top, we might be able to find the actual pinout diagram, but it's a little bit nested deep in here, so I've got it right here. So we're looking for the TFT, and you can see it's 5 volts, ground, 2 signal pins, and a reset. Now, the reset is usually the hanging pin on the connector. So what I mean by that is, if you line these up together, this is your reset. So we know this is going to connect like so on the board. And then the reset pin is going to be right here. So that's all you have to do to connect it. Now, to test it, there's a couple of ways we can do it. With direct power, which is preferable, or USB power with the jumper. You need to remove this due to your steppers later on. But let's see if it works here with just 5 volts of power. So it looks like it's coming up. It's probably going to say that there's no printer attached, which I'll show you how to deal with in just a second. Keep in mind that the default speed on this is normally set to 115-200, I believe, which you can see. We'll change that, hopefully, to get it correct to our printer board speed. So I'm going to disconnect this for a moment. Hopefully not make a mess of the desk too much. We'll go back over to the computer and do this in Marlin. So I'm going to bring up VS Code. I'm going to open an extracted version of Marlin, which is 2.1.2.1, and go into the second folder as well, then select folder. Inside of here, in order to set it up, what I need to do is find the actual board type. So if we go to the Marlin folder, the source folder, the core folder, boards.h, and we search on Octopus, and then we scroll down a little, we'll find our board right here and copy this. Let's minimize this, but note that it has two different possible MCUs that we can use. And the MCUs on the board is this board right here's MCU. There's writing on it that says something to the effect of STM32 and then something after it. That's what I'm referring to. So let's go back and minimize the core source. Go to configuration.h. We'll scroll down to our motherboard and we'll highlight where it says ramps and paste our particular board. Now I'm going to do our board as -1, but down here I'm going to enable with the control forward slash the next line, and I'm going to call this, let's start with 1 because that might be the board. Notice the speed is going to be 250,000 bits right here for the baud rate. So that's what we're currently going to be using. The display is currently 115-200, and I'll show you how to deal with that. So let's set this up to build. So we'll go to the INI. We need to set our actual default environment. So I'm going to go to, let's see, the INI folder. We're going to find our chipset, which is STM32H7. Search on Octopus. And the first one didn't work for me, so I'm using the second one down here. There's possibly an issue with the design of the actual file it's referring to, but we'll sort that out some other time. This is just to teach you what to do. So let's go over to the INI, highlight the Mega 2560 and paste our board. So we're going to build this, and hopefully it's going to work the first time out of the gate. It may not, but we'll see. So it's currently building. If there's an issue with the build, you'll see red in here. If not, you may see yellow, which is a warning. And you can watch the build actually taking place in here. Now keep in mind that if you see a failure the first time with red, try building a second time in case something builds out of order. I believe they fixed the problem with that, but it's always a good thing. Otherwise, the first error that you see being in red, you can hold the control button and then click on it. Now that yellow's okay because that's just a warning. So this is almost built. So what we're gonna need to do is go over to the computer, or excuse me, the desktop for a second, and set up the actual USB with the SD card. So I need to pick this up and insert it into here, and then insert this into the computer so we can copy our files to it. Now let's go back over to the desktop. We know our build is right here for the binary, so we're gonna right click and reveal in File Explorer. And as you can see, this is the previous successful build. That's why it's in all capital letters in cur. And so we'll right click and we'll send this to that drive. Now, as you can see, if you want to roll back a known good build, you would rename it to this, but this is the last successful install. So what I'm gonna do is I'm gonna go over to the actual desktop for a second, pop this out, and insert the drive in here. Now, we're gonna power it with USB for the moment, or we could do regular power supply, which I'll do this time around. So I'm gonna plug it in with the PSU. So, as you can see, it's powering up. Now, it's going to say that the printer is not attached. So, we're going to have to click here. Then we'll go to Settings, Connection, Port Settings, and we'll change this to 250,000. We'll go back, and hopefully it'll go away. If not, we have another solution that we can try because I don't know what the actual setting is. So I'm going to disconnect the power to the board, let that power down for a second. I'm gonna pop this out and we're gonna figure out what it is because I know it's one of several numbers. So we'll put it in here, put it back in the computer. We'll go over to the desktop and we'll find the configuration.h. We'll scroll down, we'll change this to 2. It may be 3, but we'll rebuild and load that one. Now, obviously, I don't know what it is off the top of my head, and it's not documented at the moment, but it may be in the user manual and I just don't know it. It might be 3. So we're going to see what happens with 2. And then if this doesn't work, we'll try 3. So we know that we have it set correctly on the display for the speed because this is our current speed. So it's got to be this issue right here. So this should take a second more to actually finish up. And so what we'll do is we'll go in here and we'll look for it to appear any second and then we'll send it over. So essentially it's going to be reveal in File Explorer when we see it right here. And then we'll right click and send it to the drive again. And as you can see, our last successful build like before. So we'll pop this out and insert it in again. So let's try this again. If it's not 2, it's probably 3. So I'm going to power it up with the PSU or power supply unit. And we'll see if it actually works this time. So no printer attached. It's probably loading. So we'll give it a second more. Apparently it's not working. So we'll power this down again. And then what we'll do is we'll double check our cabling as well. Because sometimes I hook these up wrong, but they're side by side, so we know we're good. So we're going to pop this out. We're going to plug this in here again, if I can do it correctly. There we go. And then we're going to try number 3, and if it doesn't work after that, then we know we have an issue. So over here, we're going to change this to a 3, and then we're going to click build again. And hopefully this one will be the fix. Otherwise, I'm probably not going to show this tutorial to you guys and just tell you it's 3 next time I do it. But the premise behind this is to show you that sometimes things are not documented. And so you can check by doing multiple builds. 3 is about the highest I would go for this particular situation. Normally I start at 1, then try 2, and then 3. To verify it's working. So it's already built. So let's go down here and right click, go to reveal on File Explorer, right click again, and we'll send it to this drive, double checking that something loaded before. So let's do send to the E drive. Now we'll pop it back out. We'll go back over to the desk. We'll pop this back in. And we'll power up the PSU yet again, and hopefully it'll work. Let's give it a second here, and it went away. So it turned out that we had the wrong serial port for number 2, and I'll show you again what that was. Right here, it took us 3 tries, but we did find it, which is number 3 in this case, for a board that we didn't know what the configuration was for. So obviously there's more functionality on this board that I'm not showing you with the actual navigation. So what I want to do is show you a little bit more on this, because there are settings you can set on this with an actual drive where you can load it. Now, obviously people ask me this question all the time, and it's loading firmware. But I'll show you where this is so I get less questions on it. So if we go over to the actual desktop on the computer and we go to that folder that I downloaded over here. Let's see. I did download it. So this is the firmware for the touchscreen. So we can extract all here and then extract it. And it basically tells you how to install the actual firmware. So inside here, there's a configuration file that can give you settings to your actual board for your display for more functionality. And so it's a config.ini, I believe, but I have to wait for this to fully extract. Maybe we can peek in here and see. So down here, there's actually, let's see. Probably going to be in here, and there is your configuration file. So let's wait for this to fully extract and then we can check it. But essentially inside here there's settings that you can use for your particular board. Obviously, when you load your firmware, you're not going to use all these bin files, and I've already covered this in other tutorials, but this was added a couple years back after I did my initial tutorial, so I'd like to cover it for just a second to show you. So it looks like it's almost done extracting. Let's double check on it here. Looks like we got a bit of a way to go. So let's go back over to the downloads folder and hopefully we can navigate into here and see it. So here's copy to the SD card. If you click here, it'll open this up. You normally want to edit this in, Notepad++. But you can pick, obviously, some configurations in here that are unique. I don't want to go into too much detail, but your settings for your board are in here, and you can set them depending upon what the option choices are. Now, obviously, with this particular board on this particular motherboard for the Octopus EZ or Max EZ, there's no ribbon cables, so there's no legacy mode that I know of, but obviously you can change colors. There's different things for fans in here, so you're going to have to scan through this on your own, but I just thought I'd point it out for your convenience. And at this point, I'd like to thank you for taking the time to watch my actual video. And for my patrons and the people on PayPal, I will place a thank you note at the end. And please remember to like and subscribe, as it's a great way to help me out by just clicking on the thumbs up. So everyone, take care, be safe, and I'll talk to you later.